Amen. I don't know if you noticed or not, but the hymn we sang entitled, what was the title of that again? Is it In the Cross or Near the Cross? What was it? Keep Me, Jesus, Keep Me Near the Cross, yeah. Is a Fanny Crosby hymn. I don't know what you know about Fanny Crosby, but she was a prolific hymn writer, wrote, I think, over 1,000 hymns. She's put up in the category of Isaac Watts and Charles Wesley as a hymn writer. But an interesting story. I was reading a little bit about her this week as I was preparing this material we're going to look at tonight. I want to just give you a little background. As an infant, small child, she developed an eye infection. And a doctor who did not know what he was doing, rather than treating her, mistreated her, and she went blind. The infection cleared up, but she had scars on her eyes and was blind the rest of her life. All of her life now. A woman who never, other than being an infant, saw the light of day, wrote these wonderful hymns that we sing. Listen to something she wrote when she was 8 years old. Oh, what a happy child I am, although I cannot see. I am resolved that in this world contented I will be. How many blessings I enjoy that other people don't. So weep or sigh because I'm blind, I cannot, nor I won't. When she died, her mother was 21. When she went blind, her mother was 21. Her father died shortly thereafter. So as a 21-year-old woman, her mother had to hire herself out as a housemaid. So Fanny's grandmother took over the responsibility for raising her. And then there was a landlady of this grandmother who also showed an interest, a Mrs. Hawley. We're told that she helped Fanny memorize the Bible. And often the young girl learned 5 chapters a week. She knew the Pentateuch. And this is what caught my eye. We're looking at the Pentateuch tonight. She knew the Pentateuch. You get that? She memorized Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy. She knew the Gospels. Matthew, Mark, Luke, John. The Proverbs. The Song of Solomon, Song of Solomon, and many of the Psalms by heart. Well, I'm gonna stop there. I'm shamed enough. She did it all completely blind. I read something recently that went down a litany of things like that, and the end was, and so now what's your excuse? Turn in your Bibles to the book of beginnings, Genesis, where it all began. Stand with me, if you would. I want to read verses 1 through 5 of chapter 1. You know these. While you're standing, let me just remind you that the theme verse or verses passage that is driving this study, we introduced it last week, so we're early into it, is John 5, 39 to 40. You search the Scriptures. This is Jesus talking. You search the Scriptures because you think that in them you have eternal life. And it is they that bear witness about me. Yet you refuse to come to me that you may have life. That's what we're doing. We're going to search the Scriptures. We're going to look at these books, these 66 glorious books. We introduced them to you last week. Give you some background. We're going to go tonight and kind of look at Genesis chapter 1, verses 1 to 5 is what we're reading. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. The earth was without form and void. And darkness was over the face of the deep. And the Spirit of God was hovering over the face of the waters. And God said, "Let there be light." And there was light. And God saw that the light was good. And God separated the light from the darkness. God called the light day. The darkness he called night. And there was evening and there was morning, the first day. This is the inerrant, infallible, all-sufficient word of God. As we look at this tonight, may we have a better understanding of the book of beginnings. And may we go away from this place having seen Jesus more clearly in Genesis than perhaps ever before. Thank you. Please be seated. Now, a little background to Genesis, to this whole section. The first five books of the Bible, Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy, are called the Pentateuch. Now, penta, meaning five, tuch, meaning books, the five books, the five scrolls. For the longest, it was pretty much a given that Moses was the author of this. And then in the last couple of centuries, the 1800s, 1900s, there grew up this mentality called higher criticism. Excuse me just a minute. Called higher criticism, which asserted that that when you look at the first five books of the Bible, you look at these names used for God and you discover that there were four streams of thought, four influences, and it's called the J-E-D-P hypothesis. J standing for Jehovah, E standing for Elohim, D standing for Deuteronomic, and P standing for priestly. We're not going to go into all that because none of it's true, but I just want you to know if you come across somebody that's talking about this, this is where they've been influenced. It is a mentality that carries the day in many places today. I hope to show you tonight that the Mosaic authorship is testified to in the Old Testament and the New Testament. When you look at Genesis, we're going to be doing this with most of the books. There's the key idea is beginnings. The emphasis on the nation is that they're chosen. The people as a nation are being prepared. The character of God set forth in Genesis, you would see him as powerful, of course, in creative activity and sovereign in his movement among his people and leading his people. His role is that of creator, as you know from the early portion of Genesis, and a command that stands out is let there be. That's how the whole creative process is driven. This book provides the foundation for the entire Bible in its history and theology. One writer said, if you get Genesis wrong, it's like north on the compass. If you get Genesis wrong, you get it all wrong. Everything's askew. One writer went on to say, if you get Genesis 1 through 11 wrong, the rest of the Bible is off. Which, by the way, parenthetically, if you've ever wondered, why such an assault on the historicity of Genesis 1 through 11? Because if you can show that Genesis 1 through 11 is fable and not history, then you can destroy everything that goes forward as authentic and undermine God as sovereign creator. You know any agendas that want to do that, that want to undermine God as sovereign creator? The LGBTQ agenda does. The pro-abortion group does. Anarchists do. So this is critical material. Genesis, the book of Genesis. In Genesis, we see God's work of creation, the fall of man, the judgment of the flood, the spread of the nations. That's how it begins in Genesis 1 through 11. And then there's a shift in chapter 12. So I want us to stop right now. You heard Brother Norman speak about it. I talked about it last Sunday night. We're going to take a look at a couple of videos, one right now, from the Bible Project. This is their overview of Genesis 1, 1 through 11. In fact, it's overview of Genesis where they show you how it breaks into two major portions. Let's see this first video, please.
The first book in the Bible is a book you've probably heard of. It's called Genesis.
Genesis comes from a Hebrew word. It's pronounced reshit, and it just means beginning.
Now, there's a lot of stories from the book of Genesis, and it's easy just to pull out a specific story and try to tell you what it might mean. But we think the best way to understand this book is to look at the book as a whole and show you how the whole thing is designed.
The book is designed to fall into two main parts. You have chapters 1 through 11, which is telling the story of God and the whole world. And then you have the second part, which is about God and Abraham's family, as chapters 12 through 50. And how the two of those parts relate, that's where you find the message of the book.
Okay, so let's start back at the beginning. The first part of Genesis begins with a creation story, where God creates everything.
And how exactly that happens, of course, that's where all the debates come. But he takes a dark, watery chaos, and he turns it into a beautiful garden where humans can flourish.
That sounds nice.
It does sound nice. In fact, 7 different times God says of all that he's made that it's good.
And this is where we meet the first human characters in the Bible, Adam and Eve.
They're both individual characters, but they're also representative. Adam is the Hebrew word for humanity, and Eve is the Hebrew word for life. And God creates them in his image. In other words, humanity reflects or is meant to reflect the creativity, the goodness, and character of the Creator out into the world that he's made. And they're supposed to reproduce and make cultures and neighborhoods and art and gardens and everything else. But he gives them a moral choice about how they're going to go about building this world. And this is what the tree of the knowledge of good and evil is all about.
And he tells them, don't eat of the fruit of this tree or you will die. What's that all about?
So up till now, God has been the one defining and providing what is good. And so God is the one with the knowledge of good and evil. But now this tree represents a choice. Will the humans trust God's definition of good and evil, or are they going to seize the opportunity and define good and evil for themselves?
And Adam and Eve eat the fruit.
This is the core biblical explanation for that concept of sin, that desire to call the shots myself. It's the inward turn of the human heart to do what's good for me and my tribe, even if it's at the expense of you and your tribe.
And the problem is humans are horrible at defining good and evil without God. And so now that humanity's made this choice, things get really,
really, they're really bad. So Genesis 3 through 11 is like tracing this downward spiral of all humanity. So Adam and Eve, they can't trust each other anymore. And so there's a little story about how they were naked and felt fine about it beforehand, but now they feel shameful because all of a sudden Adam's definition of good and evil might be different than Eve's, and so they hide from each other.
Then there's another story of temptation. Cain is jealous of his brother Abel, and he gives in and kills him.
There's a story right after Cain about a guy named Lamech, and all we know about Lamech is that he accumulates wives, like property, and he sings songs about how he's a more violent, vengeful person than Cain ever was, and he's proud of it.
Things get so bad with the human race that we see God decide to just wipe us out.
Yeah, we typically think of the flood story is about God being angry, but it actually begins with God's sadness and grief about the state of his world. And so out of his passion to preserve the goodness of his world, he washes it clean with the flood.
But there's a glimmer of hope. He chooses Noah and his whole family, and he saves them on this boat.
Yeah, don't forget about the animals.
Right, and the animals. So Noah and his family are going to reboot all of humanity. I mean, he must be a pretty great guy.
But this is the story most people don't know because it's kind of weird, is that Noah gets off the boat and he plants a vineyard and he gets totally plastered. And then something sketchy happens in his tent with his son. It's a tragic story.
So from here, humanity grows again, but things are as bad as before. And the last story is the famous story of the Tower of Babel.
And in this story, you have all of the nations uniting together to use this new technology they have, the brick. And they want to make a name for themselves and build this big city with a huge tower that will reach up to the gods. But God knows that this city will be a nightmare. And so in his mercy, he scatters them. And all of these stories, they're underlining the same basic idea. When humans seize autonomy from God, when they define good and evil for themselves, it results in a world of tragedy and death.
And this leaves you wondering, is there any hope for humanity?
Yes. Yeah, there is. It's the very next story that answers that question. It's the beginning of God's mission to rescue and restore his world.
Hey there, this is Tim.
And this is John.
We believe the best way to understand the Bible is to get a grasp of its overall storyline.
One thing to know about Tim is that he got his doctorate in Hebrew.
So you see this little bit of an overview of the first 11 chapters of Genesis. Now, I told you I'm not going to follow exactly their flow of things, but we want you to see it because I think they very artfully tie together some ideas that you're going to see sticking out as we go through the Bible. Now, the next video that we're going to show you is of chapters 12 and following. They talked about the bridge link. I just want you to go ahead and see the rest of this before we get into some of the themes and events and to see for ourselves how we understand Genesis and where we're going to see, how we're going to see Jesus. So let's cue up part two, if you would, and let's show the folks the bridge and Genesis.
We're walking through the book of Genesis, which is made up of these two main parts.
And the first part begins in the garden, where we watch humanity spiral downward in self-destruction, and it ends in the Tower of Babel, where a rebellious humanity is scattered by God.
Then the second part of Genesis zooms in and focuses on just one family.
And right in the middle is this story that links the two parts of Genesis together and helps us understand what the whole book is all about.
So how do we get from the Tower of Babel to the story here in the middle?
Well, after the scattering at Babel, there's this genealogy, and it follows one of the tribes all the way down to this one guy named Abram.
You probably know him as Abraham.
And God starts making all these promises to Abraham, like he's going to bless him and give him a ton of kids. And he says that through him and his family, all the nations of the earth are now going to find God's blessing. So basically, God is trying to restore humanity back to the goodness of the garden and to his original intentions for the world. So it's like his rescue plan for humanity. And that's why the whole second half of Genesis is about this one family. And so you have Abraham, and then he has his son Isaac, who has Jacob, and then Jacob has 12 sons. And to each generation, God renews his promise to bless them and all nations through them.
So because of this promise to use this family to rescue the world, it's pretty easy to read these stories as examples of how to be a good person.
But actually, for the most part, this family is totally dysfunctional. So for example, let's go back to Abraham. This whole story is about God giving him and his wife Sarah a family, but two different times. He basically gives Sarah away to other men by denying that she's even his wife. And then Sarah gets impatient about having a son, and so she makes Abraham sleep with her servant girl, which then causes all of these other problems in the family.
So they get really old, and you begin to think that there's no way they're going to have a kid of their own. But then, miraculously, they do. It's Isaac.
And Isaac, he has two sons, Esau and Jacob, and it seems like things are going pretty good.
But Jacob, the younger brother, wants the family's inheritance, which belongs to Esau, the older brother. So he devises a plan where he's going to steal it from his father, Isaac, who at this point in the story is now old and blind.
Which, who does that? Horrible, stealing from your blind father.
Yeah, and then he just takes off.
So Jacob goes on from there to have 12 sons, big family. But Jacob loves his 11th son, Joseph, way more than all the others. And so he gives him the special Technicolor dream coat. And his brothers, because of this, come to hate him.
So much so that they plan on killing him.
But they don't. They instead just sell him as a slave down in Egypt.
Now, while in Egypt, through this crazy series of events, Joseph goes from being in a prison cell
to becoming the second in command there.
And so later on, the whole Middle East falls into this food shortage. And Joseph's brothers, they come down to Egypt looking for food. And then when they get there, who should they find as the ruler of the whole land?
It's Joseph, that guy they sold into slavery. But he actually saves them from starving to death.
And so here you have it. These are the great-grandchildren of Abraham who have done this heinous act to their brother, but God has transformed their evil into something good.
And that's exactly what Joseph says here in the last paragraph of the entire book. He says, "You guys planned all of this for evil, but God planned it for good, to save people's lives."
Now, these words, they conclude the book because they actually summarize the message of the whole story so far. Humans keep choosing evil, and we are thinking they're screwing up God's plan, but he keeps turning their evil back into good. And somehow, he's going to use this family to restore humanity back to the garden.
So that's the book of Genesis. But we still don't know how exactly he's going to use this family to bring us back to the garden.
Well, yeah, but this is just the first book, so that's what the rest of the Bible sets out to answer.
Hey there, I'm Tim.
Okay. And this is John.
We believe all the right. best way...
So a good little visual overview of this. I would remind you, these videos come from an app you can get on your smartphone called Read Scripture, or you can go directly to YouTube and search the Bible Project and find all of these videos there as well. So now, when you look at Genesis, these 50 chapters, as we've seen in a brief video, cover human history from creation to Babel, from Abraham to Joseph. So verse 11 chapters, creation to Babel, 12 through 50, Abraham to Joseph. God is introduced as the creator, beginning life and sin and judgment and family and worship and salvation. This all flows out of 1 through 11. The remainder of the book focuses on four patriarchs. So let's see this. These four events from Genesis 1:1 to 11:9 are creation and the fall and the flood and then the growth of the nations. In creation, God is sovereign creator. He creates matter, he creates energy, he creates space, he creates time, and he moves, as we've talked about before, to where man is the pinnacle of creation. It is very good, is what he said when he created man. But the fall follows. Creation is followed by corruption. In the first sin, Adam and Eve are separated from God. And in the second sin, man is separated from man when Cain kills Abel. But even in the midst of all that, God promises redemption through the seed of the woman, and that's going to be one of the images of Jesus. Then there's the flood. As man grows and multiplies, sin multiplies with him. God is compelled through his sadness and his wrath to destroy humanity. He does that with the exception of Noah, his wife, his sons, and their wives. What does it teach us about the nations? It teaches the unity of the human race. Paul says this in Acts 17. He's made all men of one blood. You trace it all back to Adam. That reality, it seems to me, should shatter any rationale for bigotry, any rationale for the idea of a superiority of one race over another. We all trace back to Adam. And of course, after the flood, we all trace back to Noah. There's four people emphasized in Genesis. Abraham, God calls him in chapter 12, and we're going to see the pivotal part he plays because it's to Abraham that the covenant promise is given. We'll look at that a little later. Then Abraham passes this on to Isaac. God's going to reestablish the covenant with him. Then Isaac to Jacob. And we know that Jacob is transformed in his encounter with God from a very selfish deceiver, this is what his name means, to Israel, the prince of God, the father of the 12 tribes. And then Joseph, which is interesting here, because you're not following true firstborn lineage when you see the four pivotal people. Joseph, as was cited to you, is the 11th child, Jacob's favorite son, and yet God uses him mightily to save the nation when they go down to Egypt during the famine. So Genesis 1:1 through 11:9 takes on the beginning of the human race, 11:10 and following, the beginning of the Hebrew race, and as was already shown you in the video, 12 and following, that's sketched out through one man, Abraham. Real quickly, just to give you a time frame, this is set around 4004 B.C. to 2090 B.C. in what's called the Fertile Crescent, the area from Eden to Haran. It takes the first, think about this now, Genesis 1 through 11 takes in about 2,000 years. That's about as much as the rest of the Bible, the first 11 chapters of Genesis. Then from 2090 to 1897 B.C., they're about there in Canaan, in the land of Canaan, for 193 years. Genesis 12 to 36 covers that. And then Egypt, Canaan, Egypt, for 93 years. And you see, then that's Genesis 37 to 50. And so you kind of just kind of get a graphic of that. I think we have the next, put the next graphic up if you would. And that just kind of gives you a little more detailed look of chapters 1 to 11, the death of Terah. And so that shifts over to Joseph. And you see how that, the flow of that. So you're looking at Genesis encompassing there about 2,300 years. I'm going to give you a little different look of the flow of this through personalities. As it's introduced in chapter 1, verse 1 to 2, verse 3, then the heavens and earth are created. Then you follow Adam and Noah, the sons of Noah, Shem, Terah, Ishmael, Isaac, Esau, and Jacob, and of course his sons. Real quick, I want to just look at some scripture for the authorship issue. As I said, it's been generally accepted that Moses is the author of Genesis. In fact, the author of the whole Pentateuch, Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy. Look at what the Old Testament says, though, in terms of Mosaic authorship. Exodus 17:14, the Lord said to Moses, write this as a memorial in a book and recite it in the ears of Joshua, and I will utterly blot out the memory of Amalek from under heaven. And so he's telling Moses, God told Moses to write these memoirs, these records of God's dealings. In Leviticus 1:1-2, the Lord called Moses and spoke to him from the tent of meeting, saying, speak to the people of Israel and say to them, when any one of you brings an offering to the Lord, you shall bring your offering of livestock from the herd or from the flock. And we see these kind of rituals spelled out in detail in Leviticus. In Numbers 33:2, Moses wrote down their starting places, stage by stage, by command of the Lord. And these are their stages according to the starting places. So what Moses is doing, he's responding to the command of the Lord. And in Deuteronomy 1:1, so we're looking at all five books of the Pentateuch here. These are the words that Moses spoke to all Israel beyond the Jordan in the wilderness, in the Arabah opposite Suf, between Paran and Tophel, Laban, Hazeroth, and Dizahab. And then Joshua. Notice the words of Joshua, chapter 1, verse 7. Be strong and very courageous. Be careful to do according to all the law that Moses, my servant, commanded you. This is God exhorting Joshua to take his position as leadership. All the law that Moses, my servant, commanded you. Do not turn from it to the right hand or the left, that you may have good success wherever you go. And then a couple of references from Kings, 1 Kings 2:3. Keep the charge of the Lord your God, walking in his ways and keeping his statutes, his commandments, his rules, his testimonies, as it's written in the law of Moses. You see there? So in the days of the kings, they're being instructed to follow that which Moses wrote by command of God. 2 Kings 14:6. He did not put to death the children of the murderers according to what is written in the book of the law of Moses, where the Lord commanded, fathers shall not be put to death because of their children, nor shall children be put to death because of their fathers, but each one shall die for his own sin. And so they're responding that way, they're following the law. Ezra, the scribe, Chapter 6, verse 18, they set the priests in their divisions and the Levites in their divisions for the service of God at Jerusalem, as it is written in the book of Moses. What am I doing? I'm just showing you how the Old Testament references Mosaic authorship in the Pentateuch. Nehemiah 13:1. On that day they read from the book of Moses in the hearing of the people. Remember that great revival that took place when they recovered the book of the law? And in it was found written that no Ammonite or Moabite should ever enter the assembly of God. And in Daniel 9:11-13, all Israel has transgressed your law. This is Daniel crying out to God on behalf of the people. And turned aside, refusing to obey your voice. The curse and oath that are written in the law of Moses. See there, in the time of Daniel, still referencing that. And so, verse 13, as it's written in the law of Moses, all this calamity has come upon us. And then the last prophecy of the Old Testament, Malachi chapter 4, verse 4. Remember the law of my servant Moses, the statutes and rules that I commanded him at Horeb for all Israel. So I think we could do this multiplied times over. Just a sampling here to let you see that the Old Testament is replete with assertions to the authorship of Moses as the author of the Pentateuch, the Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy. But what does the New Testament say? Well, Matthew 8, verses 4. This is Jesus speaking. Jesus said to him, "See that you say nothing to anyone, but go, show yourself to the priest and offer the gift that Moses commanded for a proof to them." Jesus cites the commands of Moses. Mark 12:26. "As for the dead being raised, have you not read in the book of Moses, in the passage about the bush, how God spoke to him saying, 'I am the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob?'" So Jesus again cites written material, the Old Testament, particularly the section written by Moses, as Mosaic authorship. Luke 16:29. "But Abraham said to the rich man who's died and he's in Hades, 'They have Moses and the prophets, let them hear them.'" John 7:19. "Has not Moses given you the law? Yet none of you keeps the law. Why do you seek to kill me?" This is Jesus chiding the religious leaders. Acts 26:22. "To this day I have had the help that comes from God, and so I stand here testifying both to small and great, saying nothing but what the prophets and Moses said would come to pass." This is Paul making his appeal, that my word is in line with what Moses said would come to pass. And then Romans 10:19. "But I asked, did Israel not understand? First Moses says," and there's a citation, "I will make you jealous of those who are not a nation. With a foolish nation I will make you angry." And then Paul in 1 Corinthians 9:9, "For it's written in the law of Moses, you shall not muzzle an ox while it treads out the grain." In 2 Corinthians 3:15, "Yes, to this day, whenever Moses is read, a veil is over their heart." So you see this, and we could go on and on again, but just a sampling here for you to see that the New Testament just takes it for granted, asserts throughout it, that when they're citing some book of the law, of Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy, that they're citing something authored by Moses. When you read the early church fathers, we won't pursue that tonight for the sake of time, they openly held to the Mosaic authorship. And Josephus, the first century Jewish historian, cited that. Acts 7:22 says, "Moses was instructed in all the wisdom of the Egyptians, and he was mighty in his words and deed." He was well qualified by God's providence to do this. Well, I'll touch quickly on the theme and the purpose of Genesis. The theme is God's choice of a nation through whom he would bless all nations. All right? His choice of a nation through whom he would bless all nations. I told you that over 2,000 years are covered in Genesis 1 through 11, but Genesis 1 through 11 represents only one-fifth of the entire book of Genesis. Four-fifths of it, Genesis 12 to 50, covers less than 300 years. And so you see this heavy emphasis setting the stage for what God would do as he assembles and sends out his people. One writer said this, I thought this was interesting. He says, Genesis was written to present the beginning of everything except God. So think about this. Look at this list. The universe. God's the author. He begins it. Man. The idea of the Sabbath. This is not a man-made idea. It's not an old Jewish ritual. God's the one who instituted the Sabbath. Marriage. You can't make it up. You can't decide what you want to be. God authored that. Sin, he's behind that. He's the beginning of sin. He's not the sinner, but sin happens in the context of God's creative power. Sacrifice and salvation. And the family. We don't get to make up what a family is, call it whatever we want. God is the one who has authored that. Civilization, government, nations, Israel. All of these things trace back to God. He is the purpose, the ultimate cause behind the origin of all of them. If you have to have a key word, and we're going to be looking for a key word in these books of the Bible, the key word for Genesis is beginnings, where it all began. Key verses would be Genesis 3:15, where God says, I will put enmity between you and the woman. This is after the fall. You know this scenario. Between your offspring and her offspring. He shall bruise your head, that is, the seed of the woman will bruise or crush the head of the serpent, and you shall bruise his heel. The serpent will deal a blow that appears to be a lethal blow initially, and it is a lethal blow, but not an ultimately lethal blow, to the heel of the seed of the woman. So this what we call this, it's the proto evangel. It is the word evangel being gospel. It is the, if you think about a prototype is something being designed that you haven't seen the final manifestation of it. This is the proto-gospel, the proto-evangel, where we're given this scenario, and you're going to see a video of this as we move forward. The proto-evangel, certainly the reference of the seed of the woman is to the ultimate seed, Jesus Christ. Paul cites this in Galatians when he says it's not to her seeds, plural, that God said this, but to the seed, singular. And he says that seed is Christ. Then Genesis 12:3, which is the initial expression of the covenant God has with Abraham. I will bless those who bless you, and him who dishonors you I will curse, and in you all the families of the earth shall be blessed. So if that's one of the key verses, is there something called a key chapter? And there is a key chapter. And it's Genesis chapter 15. It is the unfolding of the Abrahamic covenant. And I want you to look with me there real quickly. Obviously, when you're doing an overview, you can't read a whole lot of the passages. But this one we need to see. I want to read this to you. Genesis 15, the unfolding of the covenant. God expresses it in 12. Listen to this, his covenant with Abraham. After these things, the word of the Lord came to Abram in a vision. Fear not, Abram, I'm your shield. Your reward shall be very great. But Abram said, O Lord God, what will you give me? For I continue childless, and the heir of my house is Eliezer of Damascus. Abram said, Behold, you have given me no offspring, and a member of my household will be my heir. And behold, the word of the Lord came to him, this man shall not be your heir. Your very own son shall be your heir. He brought him outside and said, look toward heaven, number the stars if you're able to number them. Then he said to him, so shall your offspring be. And he believed God, Abram believed God. And he counted it to him as righteousness. There's imputed righteousness. We're counted as righteous. And he said to him, I am the Lord who brought you from Ur of the Chaldeans to give you this land to possess. He said, O Lord, how am I to know that I shall possess it? He said to him, bring me a heifer 3 years old, a female goat 3 years old, a ram 3 years old, turtle dove, and a young pigeon. And he brought him all these, cut them in half, laid each half over against the other, but he did not cut the birds in half. And when birds of prey came down on the carcasses, Abram drove them away. And as the sun was going down, a deep sleep fell on Abram, and behold, a dreadful and great darkness fell upon him. Then the Lord said to Abram, know for certain that your offspring will be sojourners in a land that is not theirs. Be servants there, and they'll be afflicted 400 years. What's he talking about there? He's talking about them going down to Egypt. They're not there yet. It was prophesied that they would go there. But I will bring judgment on the nation that they serve, and afterward they shall come out with great possessions. As for you, you shall go to your fathers in peace. You shall be buried in a good old age. And they shall come back here in the fourth generation, for the iniquity of the Amorites is not yet complete. When the sun had gone down and it was dark, behold, a smoking firepot and a flaming torch passed between these pieces. On that day the Lord made a covenant with Abram, saying, to your offspring I give this land, and from the river of Egypt to the great river, the river Euphrates, the land of the Kenites, the Kenizzites, the Kadmonites, the Hittites, the Perizzites, the Rephaim, the Amorites, the Canaanites, Girgashites, and the Jebusites. We talked about this before when we were studying through covenants, but that powerful symbolism, God causes a sleep to fall over Abram. And God passes as a smoking pot and a flaming torch between the pieces himself. The word covenant in this language, this old language, meant to cut a covenant. So you may have seen when you were growing up some of the Western movies when a cowboy and a Native American would kind of make peace with one another. What would they do? They would take a knife, slice, and they would put their wrists together, right? They were mixing their blood. That was a covenant. The word means cut. They would cut themselves and put it together. In this setting, if you were going to make a bilateral covenant, you would come up with an agreement, and both of you would ratify it. This is a pretty serious thing. So if you were going to pledge something huge and significant, you might do what was done here, cut animals in half, and both of you pass between them, walk between them, basically saying as you walk between them, if I do not hold up my end of the bargain, then may it be done to me as it's been done to these animals. I'm pledging my very life in this. That's what God did in this covenant with Abram. But Abram did not pass through it. Does that mean he has no responsibilities? No. What it means is that the covenant with Abram, this further developing of the covenant of grace, is a unilateral covenant of God. That he has pledged, I will, I will, I will. And we're going to see this develop. I'm not going to re-preach the series I did years ago on the covenants, but you're going to see this come up as we look at the books of the Bible. This idea of a covenant. Look what this covenant does. First of all, there's this promise of a great land. From the river of Egypt to the great river, the river Euphrates, chapter 15, verse 18. Second, there's this promise of a great nation. I will make your descendants as the dust of the earth. 13:16. And third, the promise of great blessing. I will bless you and make your name great, and you shall be a blessing. Chapter 12, verse 2. That's the significant picture. God is a covenant God. And he's going to send the one who fulfills all the covenants, who is himself, his blood, he says, is the blood of the new covenant, Jesus Christ. Well, where do we see him in the scripture? Well, in this book of Genesis, he is the seed of the woman, chapter 3, verse 15. He is, as chapter 4, verse 25, he's from the line of Seth. You trace him back through Seth. He's the son of Shem. He's the descendant of Abraham. Again, I reference Paul. I will bless the nations through you, God said to Abraham. He had said to the woman, the seed of the woman will crush the head of the seed of the serpent. Abraham's seed. And I want to be real careful here because I want to be charitable. But our friends who practice the sprinkling of infants and call it baptism do so because they say that these children are the seed. They're the seed of Abraham. Abraham and his seed. They take that. These are the children of believing parents. But Paul does an exposition in Galatians. And we looked at this when we went through Galatians, where Paul says he did not say to his seeds, plural. So the promise was not thinking primarily about the world being blessed through the children of Abraham, but he said to his seed, singular. And that seed, Paul says, is Christ. Christ is the seed of Abraham. Yes, he's going to be the father of a great nation. And yes, the nations of the earth will be blessed through that. But the ultimate blessing is traced back to the seed, singular, of Abram. And this is Jesus Christ. That's why Paul says in Romans, by the way, that not all who are Abraham's children are children of Abraham. Not all, just because you can trace your genealogy. But he says it's not those who have the mark of Abraham according to the flesh, in other words, circumcision, but it's those who are spiritual children who have the mark of the circumcision of the heart. So you and I, in this covenant blessing, you and I are the children of the seed, Jesus Christ, and we are that by grace through faith in Christ, his blood, his righteousness being applied to us in the new birth. He's also of Isaac. The covenant is repeated to Isaac, the promise of blessing. He's also of Jacob. He's also of the tribe of Judah, which is fascinating. If you think about it, again, let's go back to genealogy. Judah is not the firstborn of Jacob. Reuben is. If you go back and read the passage, though, Judah is the one, when Jacob begins to pronounce the you would call it blessing, but some of the things he says about the children don't seem very blessed, that he pronounces the future of these children as he's at his deathbed. And it's to Judah that the line is given to flow. This, we learn in this, by the way, God's sovereign prerogative in his choosing those whom he will to advance his cause and his purpose. And so Jesus is of the tribe of Judah. If it was a strictly firstborn thing, then he would need to be of the tribe of Reuben, but that's not the way God did it. We also see him, though, in what was called typology. Jesus is a type of Adam. We read it this morning in 1 Corinthians 15:22. As in Adam, all die, so in Christ, all will be made alive. But each in his own turn, Christ the first fruit, and then those who belong with him when he comes, belong to him when he comes. And you read Romans 5, that by one man, sin entered the world and death through sin. So by one man is the gift of righteousness. Jesus is the second Adam. He is the perfect Adam. The original Adam came and had instructions from God, and he sinned and he failed. The second Adam comes, and he perfectly keeps the whole law for his people. So he's a type in Adam. Both entered the world through a special act of God as sinless men. Adam is the head of the old creation, or the head of the human race. Christ is the head of the new creation, or he's the head of all those who come to know him by faith. There's a type that's shown in Abel. Remember Cain and Abel? Abel offered an acceptable offering of blood sacrifice, which points back to Christ. You see, it wasn't that Cain didn't offer first fruits. He did offer the first fruits of his labor. But he did not come to God as you come to God. And that's with blood sacrifice, to come and make yourself fit before God. Abel is a type of Christ. He offered the blood sacrifice, and that was accepted by God. Melchizedek in the book of Hebrews, this mystifying person. Melchizedek, if you break the name down, Melchizedek, literally means king of righteousness. And you remember he was king over Salem. Shalom. Peace. He's a king of righteousness who rules over peace. We're told in Hebrews he had no beginning, he has no end. You'll remember that Abraham came and paid tithes to Melchizedek. He showed obeisance to him. He honored him. Jesus is a type of Melchizedek. Also Joseph. Joseph, we see typology there. He's a type of Christ. He is seriously mistreated, despised, and rejected, and yet embraces that, receiving that, and ultimately using that to bless his brothers. Jesus is despised and rejected of men, a man of sorrows, acquainted with grief. He embraced the chastisement of our peace that was placed upon him. And through what he endured, we, his children, can be made made whole and healed. Joseph was loved specially by his father. Jesus is specially loved by his father. So now, I hope you get a little picture when you read Genesis, how in it you have these images that come up. Where when we're taught about these people, it's not just a historical lesson. We're taught about them to show us something of the coming Messiah. Something of, notice it was spoken of in the third chapter of Genesis, something of the seed of the woman that was going to come and crush the head of the seed of the serpent, though he himself would endure and experience a mortal wound when his heel is bitten. Genesis, what about its contribution to the whole Bible? Well, it provides a historical perspective for the rest of the Bible. It covers more time than all the other biblical books combined. It's sweeping in its scope. It goes from Eden to Ur to Haran to Canaan to Egypt. It introduces us not only to the books of the law, but it introduces us to the whole of Scripture. Genesis has been called the foundation of all the great doctrines of the Bible. It shows us how God overcomes man's failure under various conditions. It helps us understand the nature of revelation, not the book of Revelation, but revelation, what we talked about last week, of God giving us his word. Because the first and last three chapters of the Bible are so intimately related. It's a history of the redemption of man. It's not designed to be a book about all of the flow of all of history. It gives us it encompasses history, but it tells us what it does about history to teach us about the redemption of man. So we would call it a spiritual interpretation of history. And there's a pretty extensive outline that I'll be glad to make available to you. We're not going to take the time tonight to read down through it, but just I've already mentioned to you the four primary movements of it. But if you're interested in that outline for further study and reading or just to have as a reference point, I'll be glad to make that available to you. It's three or four or five pages in length. What we're going to do is we're going to start looking in the next few weeks, God willing, to Exodus. We're going to see this thing that tells us about redemption. Leviticus, which teaches us about worship. Numbers tells us about a people who are wandering. And Deuteronomy, a people who renew the covenant. So that's where we're going with the Torah, the Pentateuch, the books of the law, the first five books of the Old Testament. What I want to do now, before we dismiss tonight, is open up for any questions or comments or observations. And because we're doing an overview, I don't pretend to think that I'm the answer man, that I can answer everything you have. I can't. But if something is